We're just trying to change the world here, people.
Oh, really?
The Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing that you took that as an insult.
You mean true for you is different from true for anybody else?
Absolutely, because I can't
prove either got to be true or not.
I can't, no.
Good evening, ORLY Radio listeners and watchers, because we are live on our Twitch stream, which you will eventually be able to find on our YouTube stream. But this is ORLY Radio Show 101 for Friday, March 18th. Yes, that's it. March 18th, 2016, where we dismantle the TPP for your edutainment through mostly rational conversation that will make you go, oh, really? I'm your host, Andy Cowen, with my usual suspect, the ever-present Senator Stephen Griffith. Welcome, sir.
Pleasure to be with you tonight.
And you may be wondering why I'm calling him Senator. Well, that's one of the little things that we're trying to figure out here on the show. Our mascot is a little owl, the little snowy owl from the ORLY meme. You know, ORLY, yeah, really, that's the whole... the whole bit there, if you happen to just be joining us 100 episodes in. So that's our mascot. And a group of owls is a Congress.
No, a parliament.
A parliament. A parliament of owls. So I was thinking, well, we need to kind of, you know, step it up a little bit. Now we've got a parliament here. So following parliamentary procedure, I yield the floor to Senator Griffith. So what are we going to talk about today? Well, first of all, you know, before we jump into that, if we make mistakes, because we are bound to make mistakes, this is one of those contentious topics that nobody seems to be able to get right, especially Washington. So if you find one that you have some credible evidence for, you know, please go ahead and email it into us at orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com. Or phone it in or text it in at 470-222-6759. Operators are standing by. and we want your input anyway. So if you... thank you, Mom of Anne, in the chat room. Yes, a group of baboons is a Congress, which does say a lot. So no, yes, we are parliamentary owls. I should have remembered.
I need to get my own parliamentary robes now, so I look all impressive in a powdered wig.
I don't know. I don't know if I want the powdered wig thing. Not sure I want to go with that, but it's okay. We'll figure this all out. Okay.
Just remember, Parliament has a 2-drink minimum.
Do they?
No, it just seems like it, though.
Oh, well, I tonight's episode is brought to you by Founders Reserve Porto. There it is. Yes. So I figured since we're talking about trade deals, I might as well have a port. So this is my port of call. So that's my first drink minimum. Okay. So with that, since it is just us, and we're going to be, you know, digging through this and, you know, mostly chatting about it because it is rather complex and we may not make a whole lot of headway. I would like to switch over to a pre-recorded video by our own Fred Sims, who has a little history to tell us. And of course, it doesn't work immediately. I love it when things don't work. That's so awesome. Okay, hang on. Here we go. 3, 2, 1.
I feel so fancy. Look at all of the things that are not mine. Good evening, ORLY Radio listeners. I'd like to present this day in history. I apologize for not being on the show this evening, but I had other engagements, and I'm not going to let my segment lapse. On this day in history... in 1766, Parliament repeals the Stamp Act. This was one of the major causes of the American Revolution. It was considered taxation without representation. Months of protest actually led to the eventual repeal, but it ended up giving way to a much more oppressive declaratory acts, which were passed the same day, and asserted British government had full and total legislative power over the colonies. Obviously, this was a huge stepping stone towards the American Revolution. In 1837, Grover Cleveland was born in Caldwell, New Jersey. He was the only president to serve 2 non-consecutive terms as the 22nd president from 1885 until 1889, and then the 24th president from 1893 until 1897. In 1852, Wells and Fargo starts a shipping and banking company. Henry Wells and William G. Fargo, and with other investors, launched their namesake business. It was prompted by the discovery of gold in California in 1849, and basically was meeting a huge spike in demand for cross-country shipping. In 1911, Irving Berlin copyrights the biggest pop song of the early 20th century. Alexander's Ragtime Band, a multi-million-selling smash hit of sheet music, rather than a groove lacquer or vinyl disc like some people may think, being the first pop song copyrighted. Basically, sheet music was easier to sell at that particular time because the phonograph hadn't even been really sold mainstream yet. So those interested in the piano were able to buy this sheet music, learn an extremely easy ragtime song, and it led to massive success for American pop music with major international phenomenon culturally and economically just off of this one song. In 1932, John Updike was born. He was an editor for the famous Harvard Lampoon, a contributor to the New Yorker for years, and published some 60 books during his career, including Rabbit Run and Couples. That was This Day in History, and I hope you guys enjoy the rest of the show.
All right, and thank you, Mr. Sims. That brings us back to you and me, and the chat room makes three. Okay, so... We are not going to do a good, the bad, and the ugly, because it's all good, possibly bad, possibly ugly, possibly good, I suppose, since we don't really know. So, what is the TPP? It stands for Trans-Pacific Partnership, right?
Correct.
Okay.
For, as a very quick breakdown, for anyone who's been around since the Clinton era, if you're familiar with NAFTA... It's basically a... NAFTA was also a trade deal. Imagine that just on a much, much more massive scale, and it allows a lot more... I hate to even call them freedoms, but it gives a lot more power to multinational corporations, even irrespective of their individual governments, where whatever country they might be residing in.
Okay. So, if memory does serve... Ross Perot was very anti-NAFTA.
Yes.
Something about a big sucking sound, I think, that he's talked about with jobs and money just going south.
And in truth, if you look at the numbers, he's basically right. Even back then, it's NAFTA, but also looking at the TPP. If you were a multinational corporation, you could not be happier. This is going to be a... great windfall for you, or if you're big enough to think about going multinational, you're going to be amazed. It's going to be everything's going to be coming up for you in this deal. If you are anybody else, you're going to get screwed some way, somehow, especially if you don't happen to live in a developed country.
Well, that doesn't sound very good.
No, unfortunately, and if you look at the people who are championing this tend to be the standard ones who always scream about, hey, the free market, we have to let the free market decide how things are done. Or there are a lot of these quote-unquote fiscal conservatives who are very much hardcore pro-business, but tend to not be, let's say they tend to be in the pocket of said businesses. There are sections of this, again, for anyone who really wants to take a look at the documentation, I've spent the last week going over videos, reading. Even I am having problems grasping all of the stuff, so I can only go into so much, but there's plenty out there to read. Yeah. Please take a look at it if you get interested after the show is done. We might even have enough to go two or three more shows deep.
Yeah, and we'll add some links to the show notes. That's pretty much all that this is going to be. So let's think here. Now, how many countries are involved in the TPP?
Pretty much... any country which has a border with the Pacific Ocean, thus the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So it's everything from Canada down, from our side, all the way down through Chile. And then you're talking Russia, Korea. I do not believe China is directly involved in it, but I do know Japan is. I do know most of the South Pacific Asians countries are. So is Australia. Again, you're dealing with a single trade deal which will affect about 40% of the entire world's economy.
40%.
and over 700 million people.
That's a good chunk.
Definitely. I mean,
at least of the developed world.
Yeah, I mean, we're one of the biggest ones, so we, of course, are giving a massive percentage boost to how much that is.
Yeah, we're somewhere around 310 million in population.
But also on the percentage of the world's economy, we happen to be the biggest economy in the world still. But you're still dealing with all of these. Again, it's a multinational corporation bill that's going to be wonderful for these groups that is going to has the potential to, if it screws up, or if one of these people screws up, 40% of the world economy is going to go into turmoil, which, as we saw with the housing bubble collapse here, how much that spiraled out of control and affected everybody, that was nothing compared to what this is able to affect.
Okay. As I was going through, just trying to find links and things like that, headlines of, you know, what is the TPP? TPP trade deal will cost U.S. 448,000 jobs, says researchers. Broken promises, how congressional Democrats are pushing the TPP to the brink. TPP deal reached. TPP deal signed in New Zealand, a threat to internet freedom. TPP tech corporations win, working people lose. Don't forget the national security case for the TPP trade deal. Hillary finally comes out against the TPP. UN says TPP threatens indigenous rights. TPP promotes building products exports. TPP equals a massive, in big bold letters, jobs killer. I didn't find anything positive in the media at all except from the White House.
Unfortunately, that's basically correct. If you get into it, and if you get into the minutia of it and how it affects and how it can be used, there for everybody out there, for the standard workers and everything else, there is nothing in this bill that is actually for you. It's going to be allow outsourcing of jobs even more for companies. It's, as Robert Reich put it, and I agree completely, it's a race to the bottom globally.
Yeah. That's not so good. That's super terrible, really. I got some videos here. Al Jazeera, if I can get to it and then mute it real fast, and I'll cue it up. Because really, with this kind of thing, infographics and things like that are kind of nice to see. So let me add...
I can't draw enough yet.
Hmm?
I can't draw well enough for that yet.
It's true. That's okay. Screen capture, we'll do this guy right over here. Okay, so there we go. All right, here we go. Let's see what Al Jazeera had to say about this.
If hundreds of corporate lobbyists write a trade deal that no one reads, will it still affect you? Yeah. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is the largest trade deal in US history, covering 40% of the global economy. It'll increase exports between 12 countries and impact jobs, food, the environment, and more. President Obama says it's good for everyone, but why are he and other leaders keeping it under lock and key? Four chapters were leaked, and here's what the critics say would happen if it passes. Corporations will be able to sue countries in secret tribunals for making laws that cut into their projected profits, like a cigarette company suing a country over packaging. It'll give Big Pharma a monopoly on drug patents, which will drive up the costs of drugs that treat illnesses like cancer and malaria. And the TPP also undermines internet freedoms. It forces service providers to police the net by cracking down on things like illegal downloads. So is this really a trade deal or a Trojan horse for multinational corporations?
Ah.
40% of the global economy.
Hang on,
it'll increase exports.
There we go. Okay. So Australia, Brunei, Canada, Chile, Japan, Malaysia, Mexico, New Zealand, Peru, Singapore, of course, the United States, and Vietnam. So that's who's involved here.
And 40% of the world's economy, right there in those 12 countries.
That's very difficult. Let's see if I can refresh your video. There it goes. Okay.
There we go.
Yeah. It wasn't you. It was me.
That's right.
I think I need to put a heat sink on this thing, maybe. I don't know.
But did you hear me?
I did hear you. Yeah. Yeah. Your audio is coming through a different channel than the video. So sometimes splitting things up works. Okay. So the deal, such as it is, that says so many bad things.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever played Shadowrun?
Oh, yes.
Okay. For those of you not in the know, in the geekdom, Shadowrun is essentially set in a dystopian future world from I can't remember the exact year that it started, but essentially it's an alternate future within the same basic historical timeline of Earth.
99, I think, is when it actually started, when the awakening occurred.
Yeah, yeah. So this awakening, all of a sudden you get elves, you get trolls, you get all sorts of, dwarves and everything else. Magic and dragons and things like that. But the big feature is that governments are almost relegated to second-class citizens to corporations. Giant multinational corporations.
Megacorps.
Rule the world. Sadly, perhaps a little prophetic.
Again, I see things like that. I see things from movies and books, and I kind of go, guys, these were meant to be amusing and fun to play in. These were not meant to be how-to guidelines, or this is where we need to go.
Craziness. And apparently there is distortion and popping back. I'm not hearing it. Steven, are you hearing it?
I'm not hearing it.
Okay, we're going to have to soldier on. I will, however, remove this region here, and perhaps that was causing the problem. Hard to say. Okay, I'll also bring some of the volume back down, and we should be good, I hope. All right, so carrying on. So, yeah, along with 1984, in that the government still reigns supreme. So I don't know what... Now I'm distracted because apparently our audio is going out horribly to the stream, and I don't like that. What can we do? What is it? Let's see, it's not on this one. And if I mute that, then you guys won't hear me at all. I hate troubleshooting in the middle of a show. Sometimes I need to, though. Okay, we're just going to have to keep going. But I could do? I could give us a quick break for our logical fallacy of the week and hope that that solves some things.
Hi, ORLY Radio listeners. This is Ren with your logical fallacy of the week. Appeal to authority. You said that because an authority thinks something, it must therefore be true. It's important to note that this fallacy should not be used to dismiss the claims of experts or scientific consensus. Appeals to authority are not valid arguments, but nor is it reasonable to disregard the claims of experts who've had a demonstrated depth of knowledge unless one has a similar level of understanding and or access to empirical evidence. However, it is entirely possible that the opinion of a person or institution of authority is wrong. Therefore, the authority that such a person or institution holds does not have any intrinsic bearing upon whether their claims are true or not. Example? Not able to defend his position that evolution isn't true, Bob says that he knows a scientist who also questions evolution and presumably isn't a primate.
Okay, so that was our logical fallacy of the week. Thank you, Ren, for jumping into the hot seat and getting recorded all awkward-like. So thank you very much for that. Okay, so where do we go from here? Let's think.
Again, from here, I think we can break down certain things, such as how these things affect everyone, how these things affect even the third world to a degree.
Okay.
The one that was mentioned specifically in the video, that has been brought up a lot actually, was the pharmaceutical companies holding on to patents. What is going on with that is the former standard for a pharmaceutical corporation to hold on to have a monopoly on a patent was 5 years. After that, then people can go through and make generics and everything else, because at that point it's assumed they have, okay, recouped their developmental costs, and they can go ahead now and make new drugs for everybody, so everything's wonderful. But during those 5 years, they have a monopoly on it and can thus enforce the – they get all that for that. No generics can be made. So unfortunately, it also means that during those 5 years, less developed countries typically aren't getting access to it because they simply can't afford it. What has happened with the TPP is the United States, actually, before it was agreed upon, was arguing for an extension from 5 years to 12 years that a pharmaceutical company would be able to hold on to that patent. I have not heard a hardcore whether it is has been agreed to, but the number that I've been hearing that it has dropped down to has been 8 years. So they started with five, they wanted 12, they got eight.
Hmm.
And again, if people think, yeah, drugs are expensive here, and I agree, yes, drugs can be very expensive in developed countries, especially ones that don't have nationalized health care. But you think about the United States. United States, average worker, let's not say average worker, minimum wage worker, you're earning federally just under, I believe, $8 an hour at this point.
Yeah.
So
on okay. average, I think that's what it is, yeah.
Yeah. So you're looking at, okay, you earn $8 an hour. Yeah, you're going to have to work an amount to be able to afford whatever medication you might need if you don't have insurance. And yes, it's going to be eating up a good sizable chunk of your paycheck, but you can still understandably possibly afford it. Now, you look at a lot of the countries that are not developed, and you're dealing with people who, if they're lucky and it's a per hour amount, they might be earning 50 cents an hour, in which case, you know, if this monopoly is there, somebody still has to pay the price for the drugs that these pharmaceutical companies are charging. These people can't afford it. So instead of having some kind of new life-saving drug that can affect them with, you know, for cancer, for diabetes, for any of these other diseases out there which can kill people, they are completely bereft of being able to get those until that patent has expired and generics can come out.
Yeah, well, just recently I had the little diatribe on the prescription drugs for inhalers and having that patent re-enabled and then not having any possibility of a generic. So yeah, that hits close to home. But it's even worse in countries that can't possibly afford a name brand medicine. Certainly not without you know, heavy government subsidies. And why would the government bother? And especially in those countries where the government is perhaps barely keeping their head above water against freedom fighters or any number of other thing. Pirates of Somalia, you know, just to think of a few.
But in a way, it gets even worse than that because of, you know, as the video showed there, and as I said, there is these special tribunals that are going to be set up in accordance with the TPP that, okay, you are a company, say you're Pfizer, as everybody knows that name.
Pfizer's a big one,
and you create this drug. Okay, cool. And you then want to sell this drug in, say, New Zealand, putting one of the countries that are on that actual list.
Okay.
And but there are regulations in New Zealand that will affect how much money you can make, and you can classify that as an unreasonable amount, as how much it will affect your profits. You can now, as a corporation, sue the government of that country to go around that regulation, and they also have to pay you to make up for the profit loss during that time.
Oh my God.
But it gets worse than that. Yes, I know, it's frightening.
Well, that
Pfizer,
just
American
to,
company.
Hang on, just to bring it back to something that we might understand, you know, from a working class perspective. So that's like a company like Universal Studios. When they were building Islands of Adventure, they would contract to another contractor. Then that contractor would then contract to another contractor, and there was another sub under that. And if any of those competing contractors held up the work of another company, then they ended up being liable for the lost time and wages and all that of the other company. So is that kind of analogous to this?
To a degree, yes. Actually, it's a fairly good analogy that you made there. The other issue we're running into is, but again, along those lines, you think, okay, well, a company here suing a country or a country out there. Okay, that's, you know, some countries are going to have things that are going to be very much regulations that we would consider possibly unreasonable, or somebody could consider it as unreasonable. But this also allows a corporation inside, say, the United States that views the United States regulations, maybe the environmental regulations that don't allow certain pollutants to be used or certain safety regulations, it allows them to sue the government over that.
Well, that's horrible.
Yeah, this is one of the reasons why the TPP is a very bad deal for all of us.
And because it's this transnational conglomerate tribunal thing, the laws of the country are superseded.
So, entirely.
So we couldn't go to the highest court in the land, the Supreme Court, and actually get any relief from it because there's this other agreement. Is that even legal? I mean, that bypasses the Constitution.
But the Constitution only involves our own national sovereignty. This is going beyond national sovereignty levels. So technically speaking, yes, it is legal.
So it'd be a State Department thing.
Yeah, this would be any kind of suits that came in from this, from, say, one of our corporations against our own government or an external corporation against our government for a regulation issue would be relegated to the State Department to be able to handle. But you're still dealing with it. No longer is in a standard court as any of us would understand it. It's in one of these specially appointed tribunals. So it won't even be in front of, like, you know, the World Court at The Hague, which most people don't realize actually exists. You know,
yeah.
Won't even be there, won't touch that. It'll be its own special little court off in the side that handles just TPP issues.
Ah, wow. Where would that court be? Do we have any inkling of that?
I have not seen anything that actually states where it will be located.
Or who would even be on it.
Correct. Yeah, that's been something that's been very obfuscated.
I don't think they know.
Who could be on it, who could be appointed to it, who would be available, and where it will be located.
And, okay, so a country reneges on a deal or something. You know, doesn't follow through on part of the agreements.
Mm-hmm.
They go to this tribunal, and they're found in fault. What are the penalties?
Again,
what teeth does the TPP have?
From what I've seen, because of the interconnectedness of this trade deal, it will, of course, the government will then be forced to pay whatever difference there was, or what make up whatever difference was lost due to them reneging on this deal.
Oh, crap. So the governments are held accountable for whatever the corporations within their operating borders do or fail to do.
Again, if we look at the example I gave, say Pfizer goes to and makes a deal with New Zealand, set up something, then New Zealand reneges on the deal. Well, now Pfizer with a tribunal can sue New Zealand through this, and if they succeed, New Zealand is the one that has to make up whatever losses it is said they took.
Out of the national treasury, though. I mean, that's...
Correct.
Wow. This is staggering.
The truly
thing. There is no upside at all for anyone that isn't a corporation.
Again, this is exactly what it's built. This is, as the Young Turks put, this, you know, the United States of corporations. This is a very much a bill for the bad side of globalization. This is hardcore about letting corporations run wild over any national governments. They can't stand in the way. Again, the shadow run thing, mega corporations taking over and governments being subservient to them.
Yeah. It's not so good. I have another video from CNN Money on what is the TPP. just to break it up, I want to go ahead and show it. Let me cue that up. And in the chat room, we're getting plenty of feedback on, you know, disappointment and all those things. And yes, we feel the same way.
Don't worry, Mama Van. I will try to address your statement there in a minute.
Okay, so this is out at CNN Money. This was posted on Facebook. Got questions on the Trans-Pacific Partnership trade deal? Allow us to break them down for you. Well, let's see what they say.
The United States, Japan, and 10 other countries have finally reached an agreement on a trade deal known as the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP. So what exactly is the TPP? It's a free trade pact that's meant to encourage more business between the 12 countries. Tariffs and import quotas for things like beef, rice, butter, and many other products would be lifted. Why are these countries banding together? The hope is the TPP will lessen some of the power that China, the world's second largest economy, has in the global marketplace. China is not part of the TPP. President Obama has been a champion of the TPP, and he's even had the U.S. Chamber of Commerce backing him. Those two haven't often seen eye to eye on issues about big business. Obama and other proponents have argued that the TPP will be good for American workers. Nike has said it would create 10,000 jobs in the U.S. if Congress passes the deal. But many labor unions worry that the TPP will encourage more U.S. companies to ship jobs overseas, and other critics of the deal aren't happy that most of the negotiations have been done in secret.
Most, as in, like, all. Because, do we know anything about this thing?
Again, we know a little, and mostly just because there's been a few leaks that have come out and a few bits of documentation that have been released, or, again, leaked. There's not been really any transparency whatsoever when it comes to this deal. It's been hidden very, very well.
Yeah, transparency is, well, it's the enemy of freedom.
Of course. I mean, obviously, it's how the terrorists win.
Yeah, freedom. Oh, man. Sorry, it demands cheese and wine. Yeah. You know? You know, opulence at its finest. It's the only thing that I can combat this kind of thing with. It's also important to note, this is already done.
Mm-hmm.
This is already a thing. We've already signed into it.
Yep. You also, know, to answer your question, Olivan, yeah, it is part of it is being spun as a way to squelch China and to block them from trying to utterly dominate, especially Southeast Asia. This is part of Obama's pivot to Asia idea, which is something he came up with, I think, early on in his second term, which was, let's put more emphasis on Asia, more trade with Asia, more even troops in Asia for, you know, to make things for our partners that are out there like Korea and Japan, to make them feel more safe against possible aggression from, say, North Korea or China.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. This doesn't squelch China. You're right. It doesn't squelch China or China either. Thank you, Pope Deadpool. It yeah. doesn't. It does not. No.
China, hey, NAFTA. Yeah, was more transparent than this is. I mean, most of us, if you paid attention to the Clinton era, and yeah, unfortunately, we didn't have the internet like we did then. But finding the information on NAFTA back then wasn't difficult. If you just wanted to look for it, you could find it and read these several hundred pages. This has been, I mean, you'd think in the information age we have now, it'd be difficult to hide all the information about something this massive. But no, they've done an amazing deal at keeping this utterly obfuscated from the public.
Now, it's already signed, right? We're already a party to this, and we still don't know what's in it.
Mm-hmm.
How yeah, it was, absolutely onerous
February
is that?
February 4th, it was signed in Auckland.
Auckland, New Zealand.
Yeah, looking at BBC.com. Ceremony in Auckland brings the huge trade pact, which has been 5 years in the making, another step toward becoming a reality. It's still facing opposition, though, apparently, as far as this article is, which is from February 4th of this year.
So maybe it's not?
But still, most, I mean, we're backing it hard. And a lot of countries, because of nothing else, they may not like us necessarily, but simply because of the size of our economy,
yeah,
they will some usually fall in line.
Was there anything that's stuck out to you as being like the worst thing ever?
I will admit that the patent thing is pretty bad, but what gets me more than anything else, and this is actually something I didn't, you know, I've been looking at the TPP on and off again for a while. I actually focused on it this week, hardcore. And something that has not been mentioned actually by anybody finally came to light. And what part of the TPP does is it actually affects the banks of the individual countries that sign on to this.
Okay. How so?
You have standard, like, you know, public banks, and you have private banks. Private banks like, you know, Wells Fargo, Nations Bank, or now it's Bank of America, etc.
Yeah, there's like five. Yeah.
Yeah. But then you also have like public banks, New York Federal Reserve being an example of a truly big public bank.
Yeah.
The best example I give this actually is Iceland, back during when everything collapsed.
Yeah, when they didn't bother to back things up. Yeah.
Yeah, when all that collapsed, what Iceland did was they nationalized all of their private banks, brought them all into the government, yeah, arrested the CEOs and such, fired a bunch of people, and then after the banks were rebuilt and were restabilized, they went ahead and reprivatized the banks. By the what this bill, what the TPP actually has, the big thing it has for it is you cannot do that anymore. It would now be made illegal. If a bank is private, you cannot nationalize it. You cannot make it public. If a public institution of a bank is ever made private, it cannot then be made public again, ever.
What?
Yeah, that blew me away.
What will enforce that, though? I mean, I'm still looking for the teeth. You know, where's the guys that are going to jump out of the black helicopter? You know, who's going to enforce this kind of thing on sovereign soil in another country?
Well, again, looking at how corporations can affect everything, if they simply say, hey, we can stop shipping these things to your country. We can simply stop making these deals with you. You want these special components for your military. Well, we can just not sell them to you, or we can jack up the price, and you have to pay it.
Wow. Daily costs, actually, they itemized some things out here, and I think this one section speaks to what you were talking about. Let's see, where is it? The lack of any enforceable currency manipulation rules in the TPP mean that any export gains that U.S. firms and their workers might see could be erased overnight. The side agreement, which is not included in the main text, is unenforceable window dressing designed to secure votes but not to provide U.S. workers, not to protect U.S. workers.
Yeah.
TPP means lost jobs, lower wages. The agreement includes failed labor provisions that have already proved themselves ineffective. In the case of Colombia, it provides extraordinary legal rights for foreign investors and no tariff barriers between other TPP countries and the United States. Global companies have every incentive to move more production overseas for export to the U.S. market. Meanwhile, already powerful global firms will have even more leverage to fight responsible labor, environment, and consumer protection laws through ISDS, corporate courts. ISDS. What is that acronym? Investor State Dispute Settlement. ISDS, Investor State Dispute Settlement. So that's the tribunal court, essentially.
Hmm.
It's interesting. Their little article of, here are five things in the TPP that are worse than we've been promised. That was number five. The first thing, the auto rules of origin are so low that a car or truck could be majority made in China and still qualify for TPP tariff benefits. The 45% nominal TPP car and truck content requirement has loopholes so large you could drive a truck through them. Loopholes such as lower content requirements for certain import car parts. The TPP is an outsourcing deal, not a trade deal. That kind of makes sense when you drop all the tariff barriers between countries. There's no incentive to keep it in a country.
Exactly. It's, again, this is going to allow all these corporations, all these multinationals, to ship jobs out as fast as they can to other countries where they will be able to get, you know, lower pay for the workers.
Yeah, they might as well be the same country.
Pretty much.
That's what happens when you lower those tariffs.
I mean, I know how many people were just angry over seeing what happened in that carrier plant up in, I believe it was Wisconsin, where the head of that plant actually came up and said, "Hi, sorry, we're letting you all go and removing all your jobs to Mexico." That's something that is going to happen on a regular basis.
Was that Nabisco?
Mexico.
Was that Nabisco with the Oreos?
No, that was a Oreo Carrier air conditioning
system. Oh, yeah, Carrier. Did they move to Canada?
They constructed the plants.
They moved to Canada or Mexico? Can't remember.
Yeah, it was Mexico they were moving them to.
Mm. Delightful. Mama Van, I don't know if any countries can back out of this deal at a later date. I imagine they can, but I imagine that there would be enormous penalties to, you know, keep them in. Tariffs are necessary.
Things like this sometimes also have teeth because they tend to get affected by or written into things like the World Trade Organization or the International Monetary Fund, which sometimes first world nations use, but first world nations usually, or should I say more developed nations, typically contribute to.
Yeah.
But all the developing nations, think of the IMF and the WTO, the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, as a lending bank. You want to start a business, they are more than happy and willing to help lend you this money to help you start that business, but God help you if you miss your payments. Now, a few payments, that's fine, but they will wreck you if you miss more than enough. And by wreck you, I mean they will then come in and say, all right, yeah, your name is still on the business logo, but now we're running the business. We're going to tell you how to do it and exactly how to pull this stuff off, because we're getting our money back no matter what.
So, slightly short of busting kneecaps, instead they send in accountants and own you.
Kind of, yeah.
So it's a mafia made of accountants.
Again, mega corporations taking over.
Okay. I feel like I really should have perhaps gone and got a CPA license.
I'm considering after all this going back and getting a freaking master's in economics.
Yeah, after all this, it's like, wow, economics, money, follow the money. I've said it before a dozen times, at least every episode. Let's see here. Popular Buy American purchasing rules will be watered down. This means that the Department of Veterans Affairs, the Department of State, and even the Department of Homeland Security will be required to treat bidders from every TPP country as if they were U.S. bidders when making many purchasing decisions. This will simply send more jobs overseas, no matter what.
I mean, again, like I said, the lowest amount of stuff can be made out of a product. And, you know, like 10% of this thing was actually made in America. The rest was made everywhere else. And, oh, look, it's still classified as made in America.
Yeah, so, like, we could make, because of a patent on Kevlar, you know, we could make the Kevlar here in the United States. That is then a United States product. Then you ship it out somewhere else, and it's built into the tank. Oy. This is way worse than I thought it was.
It's an amazing mess, I swear.
More than 9,000 foreign companies will be empowered to bypass U.S. courts and access a private justice system called the Investor-State Dispute Settlement. This system allows companies to file suit. This is the tribunal over U.S. federal, state, and local government policies they think are unfair. There is no limit on taxpayer funds that can be won by foreign companies in these cases. They get to play the lottery with our democracy and possibly take home billions.
Yeah.
That's bad. any meaningful climate change measures, oh boy, here we go, the U.S. adopts in bilateral agreements like the U.S. U.S.-China deal could be wiped out because the TPP doesn't require the other parties to meet U.S. standards or pay fees at the border to adjust the cost for carbon-intensive goods. To avoid U.S. climate commitments, some companies may decide to move jobs offshore, threatening our jobs as well as our planet. Oh, wow. A double whammy. Yay.
Again, it's all about the profit. Anything that gets in the way needs to go away.
And as Pope Deadpool says, and no transparency. No. None of that would go on any books at all because it's a private investor state dispute settlement thing. None of that, you know, no sunshine laws, no Freedom of Information Act, none of that will penetrate this bureaucracy. It is outside of that.
However, as I've gotten used to saying when I'm reading this stuff, don't wait, and wait, it gets worse.
I'm sure it does. That was all that I had for that article. What worse did you have?
There is something that's been included in a lot of people who don't study international relations and the trade deals that have been made with developing countries don't know about something called a special economic zone. The TPP allows for the creations of these special economic zones. Now, you think, okay, that's great. What a special economic zone is designed to do is be a place where foreign companies can come in, have a place where they can set up, do business, and it's all wonderful. They can have an actual area that's protected, and they can do business without having to deal with some of the more onerous regulations in the country or be protected in that country and be able to employ the workers and everything else. And some people say, oh, that's wonderful. Except what is your personal opinion on sweatshop labor? Because what these special economic zones allow these corporations to do is set up these locations where workers' rights, as far as we know them in this country, are basically thrown out the window. Environmental regulations in those particular areas, gone. It's literally all about, let's make as much money as we can in as short a period of time as we can. And it's typically not even, and the way they get around it is it's not the main corporation that's doing that. It's, as you said before, it's the main corporation getting access to the special economic zone, then getting a subsidiary in that country to make all the stuff in that zone. So if anything happens, it's the subsidiary's fault, not the main corporation's.
Whoa. Okay, so just a reminder, folks, you know that, you know, you work 5 days a week, you know, roughly 8 hours a day, end up with 40 hours, how that's full time.
And you get a lunch.
And you have to get a lunch, and you also have to get breaks. Yeah. All of that are part of labor laws that were brought about because of unionized labor forces. This TPP regulation essentially allows other countries, because we've already got them here, we'd be hard-pressed to get rid of them. But other countries don't ever have to do that. Ever. There is no financial pressure that can be put on them, because that's the only pressure that matters to a corporation, is financial, to make them comply. So you know, we've heard, you know, Apple was having some serious issues with
A number of African countries. Yeah. Yes, this has happened to them, but this is primarily a thing we see among the Asian countries. You see it a lot in India. You see it a lot, especially in like Malaysia area, the more definitely developing Laos, Cambodia. We see this a lot happening.
Yeah.
And it literally is, okay. Yeah, it comes down to they get put in these situations, and it becomes for a person, they can either not work for these groups and actually starve, or they can work for these groups and get just enough money to barely not starve. And that one person might be feeding, you know, their entire family of, you know, 5 or 6 or 9 people off of, you know, as I've seen as little as like $1.25 US a day.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. Hmm. Man. So, this doesn't look like it has an upshot.
Again, unless you're a multinational corporation, if you are, it's beautiful. If you're not, it's problematic. If you're not, become a multinational, and then you can join us.
Whew. Was there any areas of this that that you felt you needed to dig in more to understand, or do you really think it even matters? I mean, it might matter in the long run, but really for an overview of how bad it is, you know, the gist of it, was there anything that you feel like you missed that you're not representing the way you wanted to?
Unfortunately, this thing is so massive and convoluted, I know there's stuff that I missed that I would love to go into in more depth. Just looking over some of the things that I've found that are a breakdown of it, for anyone who's interested, there's this man named... where is it? Jim Hightower. It's hightowerlowdown.org. Actually does an amazing breakdown of the TPP. One of the things he actually highlights on, let's see, a few of the TPP's provisions that would make our daily lives riskier, poorer, and less free. Food safety. So yeah, it can any of our government's food safety regulations on pesticide levels, bacterial contamination, fecal exposure, toxic additives, GMOs, non-edible fillers, etc., that are stricter than quote-unquote international standards, as most are, could be ruled as illegal trade barriers.
Illegal trade barriers.
Yep, because it is stronger than international, so why should we have to follow it? Obviously, it's just trying to impact our profits unfairly. And I know here's one that you love, fracking. Basically, you know, the Department of Energy would lose its authority to regulate exports of natural gas to any TPP nation. So this would create an explosion of the destructive fracking process across the land for both foreign and U.S. corporations could export fracked gas from America to member nations without any DOE review of the environmental and economic impacts on local communities.
Oh, wow, that just broke me.
Again, it's one of the worst trade deals that you've never heard of. People just don't pay attention. They glass all this stuff over. And it's this important.
This is the kind of giant, grand sweeping plot device that novels and movies use. This is not a reality that we are typically dealt. Because it's so over the top that it's unbelievable. You know, it would only live in a novel. It would only live in a movie. And somebody with a fantastic mustache would be twirling it and going in the background the whole
Robert
time.
Robert Barons of old.
Yeah.
It looks like you look at it from the outside. You look at the TV from the outside. It's like that amazing, beautiful Lamborghini or Hummer, whatever vehicle is your dream vehicle. It looks so beautiful in the driveway. You turn on the engine. You hear it purring. It's the most beautiful thing you've seen. But the moment you open the hood and take a look at it or crack the owner's manual, you realize just what kind of piece of crap you got sold.
Woo. Pope Deadpool in the chat room is asking, is there no means of criminal prosecution against this sort of human rights abuse? No.
Groups like Amnesty International and such have been trying for many, many years, and they keep trying to push for these kind of things in these countries. And I will say there are occasionally success stories. Unfortunately, however, yeah. There is very few success stories in comparison to what is actually going on because most of these are occurring in developing nations that are run by either corrupt officials or are semi-failed states that they just have no ability. You can't really enforce anything against them because they're going to look at you and go, they're not following the laws anyways, so why do they care? They're lining their own pockets and they're done.
Oy.
Welcome to the happiest show on the internet, my friends.
This is, I mean, yeah, I try to usually have some sort of silver lining or a way out or, you know, hey, yeah, there's something about this that we can make happen. But I'm not seeing anything good about this because, okay, with with human rights abuses in general, you know, we've seen that there's, it's very difficult to bring to light, A, and to remedy it through any legal means is also onerous and has to go through the politics of the country. It has to go through their legal system in order to be done. There is no, you know, the United Nations, all they can do, the only thing that the United Nations can do is put sanctions against your country. Now, in this kind of thing with the TPP and, you know, removal of the tariffs, they're immune to much of what a global governing body could, because you're already in the side agreement. So the UN asks you to, okay, so let's say we're going to pick on New Zealand because that's where things are happening. So New Zealand, for some reason, is reneging on a deal, or they've gone into super duper child labor with Oompa Loompas. You know, they're enslaving the Oompa Loompas to make chocolate. You know, and it's wonderful for the Wonka bars that we're getting in the United States. It's fantastic. You know, we're able to import them, you know, very easily. But the poor Oompa Loompas, I mean, their faces are turning even more orange than they were before. So what can we do to help them? Well, okay, if we call the United Nations, if we call any Human Rights Watch, any of these groups that are, that's their shtick, is helping those that are unfortunate and in these positions. And they try to do something, the only countries that would possibly agree with that, with those agencies to do anything to prevent them from their business practice would be countries that aren't a part of the TPP, which would be the countries that aren't in the top 40% of the GDP of the world.
Yeah.
People that essentially, for the intents and purposes of their currency, of the thing that drives their entire economy, which keeps people fed and housed and clothed, the other nations are irrelevant because all they have to do is just keep working in the TPP. So their allegiance would be keep the TPP happy, ignore everything else.
Again, look at the American public as well, as far as outcry. If you keep prices low on items, then people are happy and you're not messing with their paycheck. Matter of fact, you're showing, hey, look, you can now buy more things. You're not thinking about the fact of what the people who had to make these items went through in their host countries.
Yeah.
But wait, it gets slightly worse.
Really?
Going back to Hightower's article, he actually mentions public services, how the TPP would limit government's regulation, such as public service utilities, transportation, education, including restricting policies meant to ensure broad or universal access to essential needs. One especially insidious rule says that member countries must open their service sectors to private competitors, which would allow the corporate provider to cherry-pick the profitable customers and sink the public service. Which we've seen a little bit of that, and I have to say I believe is actually in Florida, which is sad, where with private fire departments, where you pay the private fire department basically insurance to come to your house if your house is on fire. Somebody actually had this happen. They arrived. They found out that this customer whose house is on fire didn't pay their bills, so they didn't put that house out. They made sure it didn't touch the houses around him who had paid to it.
Wait, wasn't that in a novel?
I believe it was in a novel as well, but this was actually something that happened, I believe, about a year and a half ago.
Holy crap, really?
Yeah. They took a lot of heat for it and have since switched policies, but that was something that was allowed to happen.
Oh my god.
Again, the key thing with all of this is without education, without being made aware of these horrible things that are going on, it's going to blindside you. You're not going to know how to change things. You're not going to know what's going on. I am a proponent of, you see things like this, you get upset about these kind of things. Make noise. Go out there. Scream it from the rooftops. Yeah, write emails. Sure, share stuff on social media. The best things you can do still is find out who your congressmen, who your senators are, and representatives, and contact them. Call them. Give them a voice that they can hear that says, no, I do not agree with this. And I have actually seen that change people's opinions.
It can, yeah, because they don't read it either.
They can't. They don't have time.
Yeah.
I mean, if anybody takes a look at the bills that come across a standard senator or just say a congressman's desk, and you've got to vote on this thing in 2 days. Okay. It arrives on your desk the morning of, say, Monday. It is 500 to 1,000 pages long, and this is one of 18 things you have to vote on by Thursday. Go ahead and try to read all of that and get all the minutiae.
Yeah.
You can even farm that out to your staff, which most of them do, and even they aren't going to be able to get through everything you need to and be able to break it down for you. Basically, most congressmen, because they don't have the time and everything else, are either voting party line or are basically reading the back of the book and going, that sounds great, we're voting on that.
There's a movie. I had a little graphic of it on the screen. It's a movie called They Live.
Love it.
It's a bit campy, but it's essentially this kind of thing. You know, that everyone is blinded to the fact that there's alien creatures among us, and they have infected the media to the point where it's just trying to get you to be docile. You know, just keep going with your economy, keep doing what you're doing, you know, conform, buy, watch, obey, stay asleep, you know, no thought, marry, reproduce, work 8 hours, blah, 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 blah. You know, all those things, those are all like subliminal messages on every consumerist thing. You know, we would still see it, but then we would also, you know, see the underlying thing. And it isn't until Rowdy Roddy Piper gets a pair of special glasses from, you know, a subversive group that he is able to see the aliens and see the hidden messages on everything.
And let's not forget the big thing about that. The aliens were literally a intergalactic or interplanetary corporation that were coming here to sell their goods.
I forgot that part.
Yeah, because remember, you had all the businessmen from our planet who were learning from them, then going to their planet to learn their techniques, and they were coming here to help sell us goods and set up corporations and do everything wonderfully. It was hardcore showing how business is corrupting. It was hilarious.
Oh. So, yeah, homework. Go watch They Live, because that's at least an entertaining thing.
Also has one of the most greatest lines that has been used again and again in pop culture. And it first arrived there from Rowdy Roddy Piper.
That's right.
I have come here to kick ass and chew gum, and I'm all out of gum.
Yep. I believe he said bubble gum, you know, just to be authentic. It's sad. You know, this kind of media is not supposed to be prophetic. It is supposed to be commentary on how bad it could get. It's not supposed to be an instruction manual on how to get there. But alas, here we are with an agreement. It's not a law. It's just an international agreement, which is so muddy and so convoluted that it is in that obfuscation that it has its power, because it will always be deferred to some other group that will then defer it to yet another group, and then may defer it back to the original group that has no memory of referring it to someone else in the first place, and then do it all again. You will get lost in the corporate bureaucracy of the government if you try to fight this. That's what I see. Perhaps I'm wrong. This is one of those cases I really, really, really desperately hope I'm wrong. But I don't know.
Yeah, again, I see how this is being built. I see how this is coming out. And this is literally has been hailed as legacy-making legislation for Obama. This will literally be, if it fully passes, if everybody signs on to it, everything else, this will be the capstone to the Obama legacy in this country. And sometimes people wonder why I really have a problem with Obama. This is his brainchild.
Yeah, this is the only thing that doesn't match all the things that he's done. In that I've seen. I'm sure that there are other people that are screaming at me right now about all the other things that he possibly has done. Yeah, I'm sure that they're there too. But as far as things that have hit my radar, this is completely, completely different. It does not make any sense. It is out of character. It is alien, which is why I immediately go to They Live. So, what can we do? What do you think? A call to action?
Yeah, I mean, literally just the whole, we have to do everything we can to find out everything we can about this, to tear it apart, to learn everything we can so we can tear it apart correctly and actually understand what it's actually saying in all the parts that have been hidden from us.
Yeah.
And then making sure, you know, in a way like the idea of cockroaches in a bright light, you know, or a vampire in the sun, bring this thing up and show it and shine it to everybody so they can somehow understand that, no, this isn't good and this needs to be dealt with somehow, some way.
So since we can't get rid of it, We are but lowly citizens that can only act on getting rid of people that support it at a local level, sometimes.
Because remember,
sometimes a federal level.
Anything else? We never voted on this.
No. This was not something that got voted on.
American public does not vote on trade agreements of the government.
No. This is way bigger and way nastier than any one of us could possibly deal with. So the only thing that I really feel that we can do is to arm ourselves with knowledge so that when these things happen, because it's going to happen, it might take years, because one thing about corporations, they do not move quickly. They move slightly faster than government, which moves at a glacial pace, until they don't. But, you know, even glaciers occasionally have those big sudden movements, and they're dangerous as hell.
But remember, beyond that, it's not just glacial movement. It's glaciers move inexorably. Anything in their way gets crushed and pushed to the side.
Yeah, it's really an apt analogy, I think, that governments are glaciers. So, with that, since you can't really fight it, it's going to be slow going. We're going to see it eventually. We have time to learn. So share, you know, your thoughts on this with others. Start a conversation with other people. Maybe they know more. Maybe they don't know anything at all, and they need to. So spread that around. You know, if you're wondering what the heck you can do, talk about it. Spread it around. Get the zeitgeist, you know, the populace aware of that this is a thing and just how bad it could be. There's a lot, you know, there's no good news about it on the internet, so it's easy to search. It's all bad. I tell you what, if you find something good about it, email me. That would be a wonderful thing, because I'd love an upshot. But start the conversations, and what we need to do is, as it continues to get leaked, because that's what happens with these things. You know, I said it in the last show, there's only two people that can keep a secret, and one of them's dead. So eventually it's going to come to light what is in this giant thing. And then just like the Snowden documents, we're going to have to go through it and we're going to have to figure out how to navigate it, because we can't change it, at least not all at once. You know, we're going to have to live with it. And all these systems, You know, they're super long because they have a lot of loopholes in them. But sometimes those loopholes can be used against them. So we need to figure out what those are so that we, too, can navigate the corporate, international, conglomerate, governmental, intergovernmental bureaucracy. It's really weird. I mean, and I'm really shocked, I suppose it's out there, that this isn't one of those one-world government fostered by the Rothschilds kind of thing.
I don't know. I've been listening to Alex Jones scream about Hillary being a bisexual lesbian, so...
What?
I'm sure he's said it somewhere about the TPP being this one-world government thing.
Sadly, it's kind of like that.
Again,
in a way,
a lot of people scream against globalization. I'm actually for globalization. I will say that straight out. But there's always a right way to do something and a wrong way to do something.
I agree completely, and this is the wrong way to go about this because it completely there's no protection for people, for humanity. There is no
sovereignty.
Protection at all.
The whole it subverts national sovereignty.
Yeah.
Yeah, like you were saying, the key thing we can do, and because people in general, let's say, at least in this country especially, not necessarily so much in other countries, but America especially, have a very short memory when it comes to anything related to this or politics or everything else.
Yeah.
He is. Keep having that conversation. Keep reminding people. Keep bringing it up. Keep it in the public knowledge so that we do not forget it and so that people will start being aware of it and they might start seeing things go and start questioning, going, wait a minute. And that's when you know you've got their attention.
Tech Dirt, one of those interesting journalism outlets out there, said, so according to the World Bank figures, the U.S. will gain an extra 0.04% GDP per year on average as a result of the TPP. Australia, an extra 0.07% annually, and Canada is the big winner with a boost of 0.12% per year.
Yeah.
That's such small growth for such a sweeping deal. It doesn't even compute when you follow that money. So, at least not from a national standpoint, so it has to be, like, who's behind this? Who's really behind this?
Follow the money.
Yeah. So we're gonna have to, and it's gonna be one of those slow-going, plodding through it, because the information has been concealed. Because they don't want us to know about it. Because they know it's a crap deal for everyone. There's nothing good about this. Unless, again, you're a multinational corporation or have aspirations to become one. And even a lot of them have come out like, no, we don't support that. That's not a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that's enough good news for today. I don't have I have no more energy to put towards this other than I need to go bang my head against something because it's terrible.
No, you've got a bottle of wine. Drink that and eat your cheese.
I do have a bottle of wine and I can sit here and pontificate on it as much as I like. Mm. Yeah, but that's still not going to solve anything. So keep having the conversation. You know, ask. Ask your super conservative relatives what they think about it. If you're a liberal Democrat that supports Obama on everything, you know what? Here's your upshot. Here's your upshot, and it's a terrible one. But it is the olive branch that you can extend to your conservative relatives. And you can have a conversation, and you can be on the same side for once.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God. But that, hey, you know, that's a thought. That's a thought. It's not a great thought.
You gotta build those bridges where you can, man.
Yeah. I mean, it's, It's something. It's there for you. You know, think outside the box. You know, there's nothing good about this that we can see. Maybe many, many layers down, we can find, you know, a golden nugget amongst the dung. But I don't know. So keep having the conversation and let us know what you find out, because I'm awfully curious. I'd like there to be something good in this. I'd like there to be good in the world in general. I'm not feeling it, though. Not right now.
Yeah.
So, do you have any picks this week? Let's just move right past this and just get on out of here.
I have one. It's a website I'm subscribed to, actually, on, or should I say it's a channel I'm subscribed to on YouTube.
Okay.
It's Dorkly, D-O-R-K-L-Y.
Oh, I like Dorkly, yeah.
Yeah, if you want just a really good laugh, especially if you are into any form of fandom, they especially do these little 8-bit animations typically, things that cover like Star Wars, Mario, Legend of Zelda, Pokemon, and they're like these 1 to 2 minute shows typically, these little things they put out there. I literally had my friend over last night, and I was showing him these, and he was laughing so hard that he had really problems breathing. I had just flattened him out, and now I have a few phrases that I can now say to him that will break him at any particular moment.
Nice. Nice.
Yeah, if you need a good laugh, just go there, look this stuff up, and it is just absolutely hilarious.
Interesting. There's some good stuff just there, right there on the front page. And they've got lots of articles, pictures, comics, and plenty of videos. And you can submit your own stuff, too. So that's Dorkly, dorkly.com. And that's a good pick. That's fun. That's a fun thing to have.
I think we need to pick up after all that. I mean,
oh, yeah. We definitely need to pick up after that. I have been, as you can see behind me, I've been working on the office. I've got a lovely backdrop of books and all that, and I'm still trying to round out my library. So, my pick would be this: the complete 125 year history, the complete National Geographic.
Yes, nostalgia. So,
yes, and this is obviously much smaller than the many, many shelves that would be in your grandmother's basement. So it's on several DVDs. I'm not sure exactly the full size at this point. I just got it this week. But also, I got it at a pretty reasonable rate. I mean, it was only like... it was under $30 online. So you can definitely find it. Let's see, it's 7 DVDs, and it's got, you know, 125 years of National Geographic history in it. So that's, this is one of those, I'm just having all this information available for my young children so that when they need to do a research project, they have all that, and they don't have to worry about citing references from Wikipedia. So there's, you know, there's 1 and 2 full sets of encyclopedias here, and I've actually gotten a more recent release as well. Then that's going to be arriving sometime in the next week or two. You know, book post is actually fairly cheap, which is good because they're awfully heavy. But so just trying to have the offline media. You know, I know it's just a complete anachronism for somebody that is so involved into tech to have so many things that are analog, but you know, there's a reason for that. It's because I know things can break.
There's also nothing like, just again, as much as I like reading books on my Nook and everything else, mm-hmm. there's just nothing like the feel and smell of actual pages in a book.
Yeah, the decomposing tree smell that is in the pages of books, you know, with that process and everything, there is an aroma that is unique to books that resonates pretty much with all of us. We all instinctively
books.
Like that smell.
I've got a couple that I was looking
fires
to get.
Things.
I've got a couple that I was looking to get that are close to 100 years old, and they just, yeah, the scent that comes off of them is just so amazing.
Yeah, it's remarkable. So, I'm not sure which literary character said it, and by character I mean an author, but he says, if you go home with someone and he doesn't have any books, don't sleep with them.
I definitely don't have that problem. I mean, I'll show a picture of my house at some point. hope Deadpool can back us up because he's one of my roommates. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Bookshelves, so, one bookshelves in my house.
It's all about the books. All about the books. You know, it's... I have an enormous digital library, too, that no one gets to see because it's digital. It's ones and zeros. You know, you got to index all that. But it, just having the ability to reach over there and grab something that is a rare volume on something that you're not going to find anywhere else. That's really what I have a lot of. I've got books on welding and hazardous material. I've got a physician's desk reference. I've got a veterinary dictionary over there. You know, I've got, you know, books on flower arrangements, mythology, funeral customs, drama, stories, and plenty of, well, everything else, and quite a bit of fiction as well. So, but I'm mostly in the nonfiction category, but that kind of fits my personality, I'm told.
I'll have to go to your library and borrow maybe some of those funeral customs books.
Yeah, I got a couple good ones. The Egyptian Way of Death and Funeral Customs, Their Origin and Development. Those are some of my prized books. So yes, I'm sorry that the audio is rough. For those of you that are in the chat room that are hanging tough with us, the audio on our end is beautiful. And that is the audio that I am then going to append to the video after the fact. I now have, I suppose my real pick ought to be the software that I just purchased, which is from, it's from the maker of Goldwave. And it's called Video Meld. Goldwave has been around for like 25 years. One of the premier audio editing softwares available. Kind of like Audacity. Audacity has kind of taken its place because, well, it's free. So Goldwave is not. It's a pay-for-play kind of thing. But the maker also made a video editor. So I'm gonna use that. I'm gonna learn how to do many things in that, and hopefully create better content for you later. So I hope that if this was terrible for you, I apologize. I don't know what's going on. I'm gonna keep looking at it and try to figure it out. But in the meantime, after the fact, you will be able to download the show, and it will be pretty. I promise. Okay. And with that, this will conclude our broadcast day. And here we go. Okay, let's see. That's it for us tonight. We'll be back about 9:30 p.m. Eastern next Friday. In the meantime, keep those conversations going on the web. You know, talk to your relatives, talk to everybody that you can about this stuff and many, many more things. You know, it's all about conversation. Also, head over to orlyradio.com. That's ORLYRADIO.com for all the links at the top of the page. And do watch us live and chat if you can. If you've liked what we've done here, you can help keep the lights on. You can follow the Patreon link on the webpage and or go straight over to patreon.com, patreon.com/Cowen, C-O-W-E-N, or donate directly via the cleverly named donate button on the webpage. Of course, if that's too rich for you, you can still contribute to the show. How about topic ideas, corrections, advertising offers, unclaimed lottery tickets, hate mail, and unsolicited advice by emailing them to us at orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com. Also, leave a voicemail, 470-222-ORLY or 6759. And also, we still have that subreddit out there. I'm not really checking it too much, but it is still there. If you do post something, shoot us an email, too. That way, we know there's some activity out there. Also, hey, the most important thing of all is to share the show, okay? Leave us a review so that people can then find us. But really, sharing the show, word of mouth, that is really what gets us in front of other people. That's really what's spiking our numbers, and we certainly appreciate it. So like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Tumblr, Google+, and of course, subscribe to the YouTube channel so that you can see the nice stuff that I'm actually going to put out in place of the kind of rough stream. We can't thank you enough for spending some time with us. Until next time, this has been ORLY Radio, part of the Cowen Services Network. Music for the show was created by Kevin McLeod of Incomptech.com. Thanks, everybody. Bye. The broadcast has been successfully terminated.
I do believe it is in the can.
It's in the can!